It was just a year ago, August 1st, a Vero Beach high school senior, Nick Emilio, jumped into the Atlantic on a treasure dive 15 feet offshore in Vero Beach. The ocean was crystal clear. Then he saw the gold shimmer. It was a coin from the ill-fated fleet of 11 Spanish ships that sunk in 1715, with massive gold, silver, and jewelry that would name this region as the Treasure Coast. Today, people still find gold and silver on this coast. You are more likely to find treasure of a different kind, maybe even more valuable. Like Emmanuel, who escapes from the craziness of Miami to fish at Fort Pierce Jetty Park. Or the Barnett family, making precious memories on the beach, visiting from Kansas City. Or Ben, who enjoys the nature and wildlife of the state parks. People who enjoy this part of Florida's Atlantic coast for a getaway to balance the pressures of life. Welcome to part two in our Treasure Coast series. We will start on the shoreline where we left off in part one, showing a few more beaches in Jensen Beach. Then north to Fort Pierce, where you can take a horse ride along the ocean. Continue on Highway A1A to Jetty Park at the south part of the Fort Pierce Inlet. Then we'll explore South Causeway Park with a mini aquarium and Causeway Cove, where you can rent boats and jet skis. On the mainland of Fort Pierce, we show Savannah Recreation Area. Take a scenic drive along the Indian River Lagoon. Show the Fort Pierce City Marina. Then head back to the coast on the North Causeway. Show where you can rent kayaks. Then it's time for some nature as we explore Fort Pierce Inlet State Park, Jack Island State Park, and Avalon State Park. We do some Navy SEAL training. Well, really, just me. Bella is just along for the ride. At the Navy SEAL Museum. Cross the Indian River again a couple of times in Vero Beach, then Highway 60 to Sexton Plaza, where we show a couple of waterside restaurants and a really good counter-serve eatery. Show options for lodging. We explore JC Beach Park with a super long boardwalk. Stop by Wabasso Beach Park, then north on A1A to the McLarty Treasure Museum with the fascinating history of this coastline. Then to the Sebastian Inlet, where the Treasure Coast meets the Space Coast. Climb aboard with us. We have a mission to accomplish. Full throttle ahead on the Treasure Coast, Fort Pierce and Vero Beach.
There be treasure there.
It's just before sunrise at the Fort Pierce Inlet as fishing charters like the Last Mangle head out to the Atlantic. The 65-foot Miss Fort Pierce, a deep-sea party boat. It is $100 for a fishing charter from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. The slogan of Fort Pierce is the Sunrise City, and I think you can see why as morning begins over Jetty Park. We'll give the sun a chance to warm up the waters before we show you around Jetty Park. But for now, let's head back to the roundabout at Jensen Beach. This time we continue up Highway A1A. In the distance, in the upper right, is Jensen Beach Causeway that we showed last week. Waveland Beach Park, perfect for families, with hotels, condos, and dining within walking distance. For most of the Treasure Coast, there are no high-rise condos. But if you are looking to live or stay in a high-rise on the Treasure Coast, most of them are located on the north part of Jensen Beach, from Waveland Beach to Dollman Beach Park. Waveland Beach is also the start of a 13.2-mile bike path that takes riders to just south of Fort Pierce Beach. Even with the condos, the buildings are spread out and far enough away from the little beach parks where they do not cast a big shadow over the beach in the afternoon. Across the street from Dollman Beachside Park is Jane Murray Brooks Park on the intracoastal side with a nature trail to the river. Just north of James Murray Brooks Park is one of the few parts of the Treasure Coast where you get a nice water view from Highway A1A. Now 7 miles north of the roundabout, we arrive at Walton Rocks Beach. This is an off-leash, dog-friendly beach with plenty of parking. This beach also has covered picnic tables, restrooms, and 24 acres for your dog to roam. The St. Lucie Nuclear Power Plant in the distance to the left. 3 miles north of Walton Rocks Beach is Little Mud Creek, parking and a boat launch area for motorized boats on the east side of the road, and a launch area for paddle boats on the west side of the road. A mile to the south, a similar creek is Blind Creek. That is closer to the nuclear plant. Both these areas have beach access. Trails run along the creeks and the river that go on for 8 miles. There's a fishing pier along the river on the north side of Little Mud Creek. The Fort Pierce Inlet is way up here. 3 miles north of Little Mud Creek and 4 miles south of the Fort Pierce Inlet is Frederick Douglass Memorial Park. It is here where you will find tours on horseback. They offer trail rides through the St. Lucie County Preserve, as well as on the beach. An hour ride is $50. You do want to book some time in advance, I would say at least a week. I tried a week prior and they were booked. As we start to approach Jetty Park, there are two larger parks just south of the inlet that are going to be a little less crowded than Jetty Park. First, Surfside Park, with several covered picnic pavilions and barbecue grills in a large grassy area. Then a half mile north is South Beach Park, with a nice deck. Both of these parks have restrooms with outdoor showers. One thing I think more of the beaches of the Treasure Coast could use is a handicap crossover to get to the beach. Many of their facilities are handicap accessible, so it doesn't seem like it would take much to add a crossover for wheelchairs. We arrived back at Jetty Park, Fort Pierce. Unlike the Jetty Park in Port Canaveral that we showed in our Space Coast video, there is no fee for parking or entry into this park. You also have more eateries here, like the Hurricane Grill and Wings for pub grub, the Taco Dive Beachside, or the restaurant at the Sunrise Sands Beach Resort. This park is just beautiful. Multiple picnic pavilions, barbecue grills, and swing benches with palm trees line the shoreline along the inlet. Just a great place to chill and watch the pelicans and boats coming in and out of the channel. A lot more paved sidewalk space, more seating than the Port Canaveral Jetty Park that is 100 miles to the north. I'd rank this Jetty Park a lot higher, and it's free, you can't beat it. A nice place to bring the family. Here's the Barnett family visiting from Kansas City.
Well, what do you think of the Treasure Coast?
Beautiful. Yeah. Want to buy some property out here.
This jetty has a nicely paved sidewalk with benches and a side jetty. Makes it a great place to fish. We catch up with Emmanuel from Miami, who loves the laid-back atmosphere of this inlet.
We catch snook, we catch redfish, we catch jack, we catch tarpon, varieties of snapper, big fish. The other day was a 12-foot shark. Right here they had about 9 manatees. If you wanted a little bit more kickback, you know, relaxing, not a lot of college kids or something like that, this is ideal.
There is also plenty of parking in the Super Grouper Tiki Bar, as well as more parking beyond the Tiki Bar. The paved sidewalk goes all the way to the second parking lot, so makes Jetty Park very wheelchair accessible. On the other side of that lot is the Manatee Island Bar and Grill with waterfront seating. Another mile down Seaway Drive is the South Causeway Park, a quarter of a mile long beach along the Indian River Lagoon with a playground, picnic and swimming areas. This park also has a boat ramp, and it's popular to launch a kayak as well. Chuck's Seafood Restaurant with classic American seafood is located on one end of the beach, and on the other end is St. Lucie County Aquarium. This is a mini aquarium, kind of small, but inexpensive, just $325. A nice little place to cool off a bit on a hot summer day and learn a little about the coral reef ecosystem. There's a little touch tank here. Across the street is Causeway Cove, where on Saturday nights there is a drive-in movie theater here. That is about $13 per vehicle with taxes. At the marina is the Wet Whistle, an old Florida waterfront bar with live music every Sunday. Salty's Water Sports is where you can rent jet skis and boats, or take a jet ski tour or dolphin cruise. The cruise is $294 for up to 6 passengers. Also, Causeway Cove RV Park has 10 double-sized campsites with full hookups and a laundry, and shuffleboard courts. back across the street at the South Causeway Park. There are a couple of fishing piers along the beach side and another pier underneath the bridge. We cross over the Fort Pierce South Bridge with a couple of areas to show you on the mainland. On the west side of the bridge, also a super long fishing pier under the bridge. 10 miles southwest of the inlet is the Savannah Recreation Area, which covers a massive 550 acres. This area provides access to pine flatwoods, wet prairie, marsh, lake, and scrub habitats, considered one of the most unique wilderness areas in Florida. There is year-round camping with fishing, canoe and kayak rentals, a dog park, and walking and biking trails. We put a link to a website with more info. Another reason why I wanted to show you the Savannah Recreation Area is because it allows us to take scenic South Indian River Drive back up the river. The Indian River Lagoon encompasses one-third of the east coast of Florida. 156 miles long, has an average depth of just 3 feet. It is over 5 miles wide at the northern end at Canaveral National Seashore and less than a half mile wide at the Wabasso Narrows in Vero Beach. Near the Fort Pierce City Marina is Melody Lane Fishing Pier, 215 feet long, has a musical theme, commemorates the former Fort Pierce radio station, WIRA. There's a downtown farmer's market that happens every Saturday from 8 a.m. to noon at Market Square, where you can find fresh food as well as live music. The Fort Pierce City Marina, overlooking the South Causeway Bridge and Indian River. One of the newest additions to the marina, opened in 2020, is Krabby's Dockside, where you can get fresh grouper with some rum punch.
Where's me rum?
There's a live cam here that we'll put a link in the description below. The Manatee Observation Center is located here. $2 for admission. Children 5 and under are free. There are interactive exhibits, a touch tank, an observation tower, where you can look for manatees. They also have the Indian River Lagoon Wildlife Boat Tour. That is $23 for adults, $15 children 3 through 12. The historic Seven Gables House is the visitor center for St. Lucie County. The Boston House, built in 1909, is said to be haunted. The River Walk Center, where there are shuffleboard courts and regular league and tournaments happen here. A long walkway that extends along the riverfront. On the north side of the South Causeway Bridge are a couple of popular outdoor casual bar and grills with live music. First, the Tipsy Tiki. There's also Crocodillo's Bar and Grill. Okay, it's time to head back to the coast over the North Causeway. On the other side of the bridge is North Causeway Island Park. Not as large as South Causeway Park and no beach area, but a boat launch and a good place to rent a kayak with Lisa's Kayaks. There's a chain of smaller islands that extend all the way to Vero Beach here. Further east on the North Causeway is Little Jim Bait and Tackle, which is more than just a bait shop, but a waterside restaurant. A nice little eatery that is not as crowded as the other waterfront restaurants on the South Causeway. We arrive at Fort Pierce Inlet State Park. So back on the inlet, only now we are on the north side. It is $6 per vehicle or $4 for a single occupant vehicle. Within the park is Tucker Cove, excellent for paddleboards and kayaks, which you can rent with Sunrise City Adventures, or you can take a kayak tour with Get Up and Go Kayaking. A beach on the channel side, where you can lay out on the sand amidst the nature and the boats sailing in and out of the channel. There's a paved bike path, and also a hiking trail that goes through oak hammocks, where you see native trees. A jetty on the north side of the inlet. Only this jetty isn't walkable. The beach on the ocean side. We turn north on Highway A1A up the coast as we head towards Vero Beach. A mile up the highway is one of the better museums I think both adults and kids will love. The Navy SEAL Museum. It is on the training grounds of the original Navy combat divers, the Frogmen. Admission is $15 for adults, $7 children, 6 through 12. Veterans and first responders, $12. Museum closed on Mondays. Inside, you can climb aboard a Sikorsky UH-60 Black Hawk, and once inside, see a little movie. See a scale model of the Bin Laden compound, where Robert O'Neill and SEAL Team 6 took down the Al-Qaeda leader. There are sections for the Korean War, the Vietnam War, and World War II. Outside the museum, a few vessels you can climb aboard, like the Mark V Special Operations Craft, has a low profile, great for covert missions. Bella paying tribute to the Navy SEAL canines, who played a great role in the history of our nation. Well, I was so inspired, had some flashbacks to my Marine Corps training. I had to do the obstacle course. Urgh! This is how I like to play in the sand. But if you would rather play in the sand on the beach, well, Pepper Beach is right here, where you can relax and enjoy the ocean. Across the street from the museum is Wildcat Cove Preserve and Dog Park, where from Thursday through Sunday, there is a hot dog and Sloppy Joe food truck here. Also, a fishing pier and kayak launch. You can really make it a day here around the museum. A mile north of the museum is a side road that leads to Jack Island State Preserve. It is here we meet up with Ben Uvoni to tell us more about the nature of this area.
And I gotta tell you, this island is so residential that behind me, you have so much land. I forget how many acres, but it's in like the thousands and thousands of acres that there's so much habitat and open land that the bobcats are enormous. The wildlife is beautiful. It is so not uncommon to see manatees, to see dolphins here in the water, and to see eagles or falcons fly down and grab fish with their talons. It's just really an amazing place. And I'm reluctant you filming me because I want to keep it a secret. We want to keep North Hutchinson Island the best kept secret that it is.
So, don't tell nobody.
There is both a 1 mile trail and a 2 mile trail to get to the river, where there used to be a tower, but it is being torn down. However, a new platform is being built by the end of the year. Just talking with the ranger here and found out that no taxpayer money is used for Florida state parks. They rely solely on the park admissions to make improvements and build things like towers, piers, and trails. So if you are at these smaller parks like Avalon State Park, where there's just the honor system for payment, make sure to pay the $2 or whatever it is to help keep our Florida parks well maintained. Avalon State Park has a beachside here. But it's the riverside that is huge with long trails along the river. The state is planning to put in a parking lot on this side of the highway, as well as several trails. We now arrive in Vero Beach, crossing the Amalie Loy Bridge that carries 17th Street across the Indian River Lagoon. Now on the mainland, south of the 17th Street Bridge, McKee Botanical Gardens provides an 18-acre lush jungle with one of Florida's most unique botanical collections. It's open Tuesday through Sundays, $15 for adults, $13 for youth 13 to 17, and $10 for children 2 through 12. We take Highway 60 back over the Merrill P. Barber Bridge, back to the beach. Because of the wind, Vero Beach is popular for sailboating. Would you like to learn to sail? Well, the Youth Sail Foundation is here. It offers programs for both youth and adults to learn to sail with smaller sailboats. On the other side of the Barber Bridge is Riverside Cafe, a family-friendly dockside eatery with seafood menu, four bars, and seating right on the Indian River. They also have an all-you-can-eat Sunday brunch buffet. On this side of the river is where you'll find the dog-friendly Riverside Park, one of Vero Beach's largest parks, with boat ramps, museum, picnic areas, fishing piers, tennis courts, and a theater. Adjacent to the park is Veterans Memorial Island Sanctuary. Both Riverside Park and Veterans Memorial Island are ADA accessible. Highway 60 dead ends at the center of Vero Beach at Sexton Plaza. On this day, it was a little hard to find parking, but it was also spring break. On the south side of the plaza is the Ocean Grill, located inside a former officers' club. Here you can enjoy seafood and steaks with an ocean view. At the end of Sexton Plaza, an elevated overlook to the beach with benches. On the other end of Highway 60, 167 miles away, is Clearwater Beach. You don't get the nice sunsets like you do on Clearwater Beach. However, the trade-off is a lot less traffic here, less busier. I kind of prefer the beaches on the East Coast. Just easier access to the beaches. On the north side of Sexton Plaza is Mulligan's, the same restaurant chain we ate at in Stewart last week. A nice ocean view, outdoor beach style seating here to enjoy those delicious shrimp tacos with firecracker sauce. One thing I will say that Vero Beach lacks is counter-serve eateries. There's a lot of restaurants, but a lot of times you just want decent food quickly. There is, however, one really great counter-serve eatery, and that is Casey's Place. They have char-grilled burgers, grilled black and marinated chicken sandwiches, belly buster hot dogs, although I had a fish sandwich. It was delicious. A nice outdoor patio under a tree that you can eat at, but I took my fish sandwich to the beach to eat. Bella likes that cool Atlantic breeze blowing on her face. A quarter of a mile south of Sexton Plaza is Humiston Beach Park, which is ADA accessible with a playground, shelter picnic pavilions, barbecue grills, and parking. Next to Humiston Park is the historic Driftwood Hotel. Although not pet friendly, this is a cool hotel. Originally built in the 1920s, has since been remodeled, but maintains its old Florida theme. The Waldo's restaurant and pool with a distinctive rustic bar, with tables and deck that overlook the ocean and access to the beach. If you are traveling with a pet, try the Costa de Este Resort and Spa next to the Driftwood. I stayed here about 5 years ago and it was great. Also, the Kempton Vero Beach Hotel and Spa is pet friendly as well. A mile north of Sexton Plaza is JC Beach Park, one of three major public beach parks in Vero Beach. There are covered picnic pavilions, usually not very crowded, lots of green space. Also a nice little counter-serve eatery, the Seaside Grill, that is open for breakfast and lunch. The Vero Beach Boardwalk, also here, super long, about 4/10 of a mile, with street parking on one side and the beach on the other. If you are looking for an active nightlife, well, Vero Beach is probably not for you. But if you are looking for a nice beach to hang out at that is not too crowded and yet still has eateries and decent hotels, Vero Beach is great. We head 7.5 miles up Highway A1A to the third causeway, Wabasso Beach Road, which dead ends at Wabasso Beach Park. There is limited parking here, 34 spaces, but it is usually not too crowded. This is a quiet beach with a boardwalk, two pavilions, four picnic tables, a little observation deck. There are ADA crossovers here. Being a good distance from the center of Vero Beach, you tend to see a little more nature here. There is a nice little counter-serve eatery here, Beach Bites, that also has a general store, and you can rent jet skis, kayaks, and paddle boards. Really makes this a good little spot off the beaten path. Just two more places to show you. 5 miles north of Wabasso Beach, we arrive at the McLarty Treasure Museum, which is on the site of the Salvagers and Survivors Camp, of the main ship of those 11 ships from that 1715 fleet that helped to name this the Treasure Coast. Here's Corey Kirkala, an archaeologist, to explain more.
Those 11 ships were so loaded with treasure because Spain was so desperate for treasure. You still have it washing up all the time. Some people have estimated that there's $500 million worth of treasure still out there. And so we have salvagers out here June, July, and August searching for things. It's a really popular area for metal detectors, including some celebrity metal detectors that you'll have to learn about if you come in.
You can see one of the four cannons that helped to defend against pirates who raided Vero Beach after that shipwreck.
This is actually one of the four that was defending the beach site where they actually raided, and it didn't do its job because anytime a pirate wanted to come and take something, they pretty much came and took it.
So much treasure.
By the way, Corey also does YouTube videos with his son called Old Souls Travel. They do a lot of worldwide travel. I put a link in the description below. Now to the northern end of the Treasure Coast, some of the most scenic parts of the drive on Highway A1A of the Treasure Coast. Now 71 miles from where we first started at the Jupiter Inlet, we approach the Sebastian Inlet. The Sebastian Inlet is where the Treasure Coast meets the Space Coast. It is considered part of Melbourne Beach. I would say, along with the Fort Pierce Inlet, this is one of the two most beautiful inlets in Florida. It is $8 per vehicle or $4 for a single occupant vehicle. Boat ramp fee is $4. There are 51 campsites here. It is $32 including fees for tents, an additional $7 for RV units up to 40 feet. Includes water and electricity. Pets are allowed in the park, but not on the beach. There are three mountain bike trails and a mile-long nature hammock trail. Canoe and kayak rentals available from Surfside Grill and Adventures, a mile up the highway. The inlet is fantastic for fishing, with catwalks under the bridge and two long walkable jetties on both sides of the inlet. Plenty of nature, one of the best places for bird watching. We ran into pelicans Eloise and Oscar with their son Seymour. They said the fish in this inlet are really tasty. I felt like we missed some places in the Treasure Coast, like Round Island Riverside Park, Vero Beach, or Webasto Causeway Park. But it's time to move on. So if there's any areas you have enjoyed on this coast, let us know in the description below. I know a lot of people in the last couple of years have been dealing with depression, anxiety, and stress. But you know, some of the best treatment is exercise. Getting out in fresh air, being friendly, meeting people can do wonders. And the Treasure Coast, like it was for those shipwrecked sailors years ago, continues to provide healing and recovery, balancing the mind with nature. In the last few videos, you have been seeing me wearing this green shirt that reminds people that 22 vets a day commit suicide. You can buy these from the Teal Valhalla Project, who sells military and patriotic apparel, to fund things like helping to train service dogs for vets and first responders who are dealing with PTSD. And of course, if you have a dog, you gotta pick up one of these Kergo dog backpacks so that you can bring a dog almost anywhere. We are heading up the coast to South Carolina, but first might make a detour to Orlando, depending on weather, as we have just been contracted to do a video there. Which reminds me, if you would like to hire us to film a city or region, contact us at info@tampaaerialmedia.com. We are pretty flexible this summer. Also, if you would like stock footage from any of our videos, email us as well. We are Tampa Aerial Media. We film travel promos across the USA. From the Treasure Coast, I wish blessings to you, wherever you may be. See you in Orlando.